Every time a subway screeches to a stop, we usually chalk it up to another moment in the daily grind, if we even notice it at all. Commuters pour out, new riders pile in. Just another day on the rails. But what if that screech, that everyday chaos, could do more than just move people? In Barcelona, it does. They've taken the regenerative braking that you might know from your EV and cranked it up to city scale. Now, their metro isn't just moving passengers, it's powering escalators, traffic lights, even EVs. It's a sneak peek into a future where energy isn't only harvested from solar panels or massive power plants, but reclaimed from the overlooked rhythm of urban life. So here's the question. How much energy are we letting slip through the cracks, and what happens when we start catching it? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Ground News. We're at Bellvitge's station in beautiful Barcelona, and while it might look like just another subway stop, it's hiding not one, but two big secrets. The first is regenerative braking, that clever mechanism that you might recognize from your EV, which lets us reclaim some of that wasted kinetic energy and turn it into electricity. It's neat, right? But it's hardly new. Regenerative braking has been around since the 1800s, and odds are your car already uses it. In fact, it first showed up on trolley cars, so public transit has been in the game for over a century. So what's the big deal? Well, that brings us to Bellvitge's second secret, what they're doing with that electricity. As you probably know, trains, they're heavy. And stopping one, it's no small feat. Just ask Denzel Washington and Chris Pine. Now, all that momentum means a lot of kinetic energy, way more than your average car can muster. And when that energy is captured through regenerative braking, well, there's enough juice to do more than just power lights at the station. In Spain's case, it's being routed straight into charging EVs. And you heard me right, some subway stops are wired up to feed energy from braking trains into electrolineares. That's Spanish, or my bad Spanish, for electric gas stations. The program's called MetroCHARGE, and it's already drawing attention from metro systems and city planners around the world. Which begs the question, if using regenerative braking to power train stations, EVs, and more is such a no-brainer, where has this tech been all of our lives? And if it's working so well, what else could we power with a train? To understand why Transports Metropolitans de Barcelona, or TMB, decided to roll with this and how it works, let's start at the start. Regenerative braking, or RB for short. Put simply, it's what's known as an energy recovery mechanism. It slows down a moving vehicle, or really anything, with momentum, and converts some of that kinetic or potential energy into a usable form. In most real-world cases, that means electricity. Technically speaking, regenerative braking systems recover energy that would otherwise be lost as heat during braking. They do this by running the electric motor in reverse, briefly turning it into a generator. As the laws of thermodynamics taught us, energy can't be created or destroyed, only transformed. In RB, kinetic energy is converted into electrical energy, instead of just being burned off as heat. So how does it actually work in an EV? Well, first, when the driver lifts off the accelerator or taps the brake, the car's computer tells the motor to switch into regenerative mode. Instead of using electricity to spin the wheels, the motor now uses the spinning wheels to generate electricity. As the wheel turns the motor, now playing generator, it produces electricity from the car's motion and helps to slow it down in the process. That electricity flows back into the car's high-voltage lithium battery, giving it a little bit of a top-up. By recovering that energy, EVs improve their overall efficiency and extend their range. The more stop-and-go traffic a vehicle deals with, the more it benefits. That's why RB is a perfect match for commuter trains and buses. Now, obviously, a little energy snack every time that you stop is great, but RB has even more perks. The biggest? Longer brake life. Conventional brakes slow a vehicle by physically gripping the wheels and turning all that motion into heat. This stresses out brake components like discs, calipers, and pads. Regenerative braking steps in first, doing most of the heavy lifting, while the friction brakes handle what's left once the vehicle's already slowing down. Less heat, less wear, and fewer trips to the mechanic. It's win all around. So how does TMB's MetroCHARGE project actually work? Well, first, here's the thing. Depending on where you're getting your news, you might think this kind of innovation is the future of smart cities, or just a PR stunt for transit nerds. And when stories mix tech, infrastructure, and policy, it's easy to get lost in the noise. So how do you cut through that spin and see what's really going on? That's where today's sponsor, Ground News, comes in. Created by a former NASA engineer, Ground News pulls from over 50,000 sources and breaks down political bias, credibility, ownership, and even financial incentives behind the coverage. A great example? Take the story on Trump deploying 700 Marines to Los Angeles. With one click, I can see a summary, political bias, ownership details, and a factuality breakdown for every outlet that's covering it. A center-leaning source presents it as a straightforward deployment of Marines in response to immigration protests. A left-leaning one highlights the illegality of sending troops to LA. And a right-leaning source? Well, it frames these not as a protest, but major riots. If you're watching my channel, you probably like digging a little deeper, so Ground News helps you compare stories, spot bias, and catch what others might miss. Especially like the blind spot feed. It shows stories underreported by one side of the spectrum. It's helped me recognize my own blind spots and understand the nuance behind the headlines. For a limited time, you could get the same plan I use for nearly half off. Just head to ground.news/undecided or scan the QR code to save 40% off their Vantage plan. Thanks to Ground News and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to how TMB's MetroCHARGE project actually works. Barcelona's trains have had regenerative braking since the early 1980s, quietly converting tons of kinetic energy into electricity. And with good reason. The Barcelona Metro sees about 2.3 million riders on a typical weekday, across more than 160 stations and 78 miles of track, which is about 126 kilometers. That's a whole lot of stops and a whole lot of energy. All that reclaimed electricity got TMB thinking. What else could they do with it? By the end of summer 2024, they had installed 3 inverters in the system with 13 more in progress. And the results? They're pretty electrifying. According to TMB Metro Systems Director Jordi Picas, about 33% of the train's energy use is now covered by regenerative braking, enough to power 25 subway stations. And the latest news from the Associated Press says MetroCHARGE recuperators are now active at 16 stations, supplying enough electricity to meet all the energy needs of 28 subway stations. Powering the stations with the trains themselves? That's already a bit of smart circular energy. But TMB didn't stop there. Some of the surplus electricity is also being routed to nearby EV charging stations. Drivers pay around 33 cents per kilowatt hour for that train power-up topped up. As Alvaro Luna, who's the professor of electrical engineering at the Polytechnical University of Catalonia, told the AP, since the recharging stations are installed nearby, the energy instead of being put back into the general electrical network goes directly to the charging stations, and that allows the provider to potentially offer lower prices. That's a win for EV owners, and every charge helps to offset the cost of installing the regenerative systems. It's also a step, or more like a steady roll, towards Spain's 2030 decarbonization goals, which are outlined in the updated 2024 PNIEC. As part of that plan, all the municipalities with over 50,000 residents must implement sustainable urban mobility strategies through mitigation efforts. Spain estimates regenerative braking will supply 41% of the energy that's needed to power its trains. This effort is expected to save roughly 3,885 metric tons of CO2 emissions every year. It's not too shabby for something that was once wasted as heat. And speaking of heat, that's where things get extra interesting. Remember, regenerative braking works by capturing kinetic energy that would otherwise turn into heat. Without RB, all of the warmth builds up in the train cars and the tunnels. And subways made of concrete, tile, and earth are great at holding onto heat. That excess heat not only makes the system uncomfortable, it wears out brake components faster and drives up maintenance costs. Need an example? Just look at the London Underground, also known as the Tube. It's the largest metro system outside of China and Russia, and a marvel of engineering. But it's also famously hot and muggy to the point that heat warnings are common. The central line is notorious for exceeding 35.5 degrees Celsius, which is about 96 degrees Fahrenheit. Honestly, it's not that different from Boston's Green Line in the summer, and spoiler, that's not fun. And for a little context, the EU actually bans the transport of livestock like cows and pigs where temperatures exceed 30 degrees Celsius or 86 degrees Fahrenheit. If it's too hot for pigs, it's probably too hot for commuters. Since implementing regenerative braking, temperatures in Barcelona's subway system have dropped by 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit or about 1 degree Celsius. No, it's not massive, but every degree helps. Especially when you factor in body heat, AC systems, electronics, and climate change just in general. And climate change isn't theoretical here. Spain has faced increasingly brutal summers, plus a string of floods and droughts that hit Valencia last year. Anything that cools things down and cuts carbon is a move in the right direction. As the cherry on top, it's worth remembering that subways are already one of the most efficient forms of land-based transportation. MetroCHARGE just turns up the efficiency another notch. That said, no system is perfect, and MetroCHARGE hasn't been without its challenges. So why aren't we all following TMB's lead and upgrading regenerative braking across all of our metro systems? It's no surprise here, it's the cost. While many subway and train cars already use some form of regenerative braking, building out the rest of the infrastructure gets pricey fast. EV charging stations are expensive, often unpopular, and let's face it, cities aren't exactly swimming in extra cash. Plus, not everybody drives an EV, at least not yet. and some folks don't see charging stations as the best use of public funds. Without more long-term data, it's hard to prove just how cost-effective a system like MetroCHARGE really is, which makes that upfront price tag a really tough sell. There's also a technical speed bump. Not all electrical rail systems are created equal. Some run on AC, others on DC. But don't get thunderstruck, because AC systems are relatively easy to adapt for regenerative braking. DC systems are a little more of a problem child. That's because DC setups come with lossy conversions and lower voltages, making it trickier and more expensive to capture and repurpose that energy. It's not impossible, just costly. Dirty deeds may be done dirt cheap, but going green? Not so much. Even for Barcelona, MetroCHARGE hasn't exactly been a free ride. The project has cost about 7.8 million euros, or about $8.6 million. And we're not talking about the biggest metro system in the world. Team B expects to earn that money back in 4 to 5 years through energy savings and revenue from charging stations. Still, for the average taxpayer, that price tag can cause a bit of sticker shock. Expanding the system beyond Barcelona comes with even more roadblocks. Spain is a large, sunny country, but it has gaps between charging points. While MetroCHARGE has helped add a few more to the network, the EV market is growing faster than the infrastructure can keep up. Now, according to the Spanish Association of Automobile and Truck Manufacturers, Spain currently has around 37,000 charging points, which is well below the 2021 goal of 100,000. And it's worth remembering, energy conversion isn't magic. Regenerative braking doesn't turn 100% of kinetic energy into electricity. Like Bart's bicycle headlight, it's not exactly a perfect system. Trains can recover somewhere between 15% and 45% of their braking energy. It's not bad, especially when you compare it to cars, which manage just 20% with the rest going up in heat. Still, while it's not perfect, it's progress. In a world facing rising temperatures and rising emissions, that counts for a lot. So where does MetroCHARGE land on our NASA's technology readiness level scale? Well, regenerative braking itself, that's off the charts. It's proven tech, already commercially deployed, it's in everything from trains to Teslas, but MetroCHARGE, it's still climbing. With its tech already up and running at several subway stations and EV charging points, being well-received and expansion plans underway, I'd say it's at least a TRL of 7, a successful prototype demonstration in a real-world environment. And it's not going unnoticed. MetroCHARGE has had such a strong debut that other cities are eyeing Barcelona's blueprint. Late last year, TMB hosted a transit delegation from New Delhi, and they're now sharing insights with officials from Vienna. They're also bringing their findings to the Community of Metros Benchmarking Group, or COMET, a global consortium of 45 transit systems that trade metro best practices. Even New York City might get on board. The MTA has been exploring regenerative braking for years, and with 472 stations and 665 miles, which is 1,070 kilometers of track, it's a network ripe for energy-saving upgrades. Ahmed Mohammed, Director of Graduate Studies in Electrical Engineering at City College of New York, has noted the massive potential energy savings from implementing a system like this at scale. Of course, as we've said before, upgrading metro systems isn't cheap. Budget-strapped cities may find upfront costs too steep, even if Barcelona expects MetroCHARGE to pay for itself in just a few years. Still, for cities that can afford the leap, this looks like a smart way to take something already efficient and make it even better. Saving energy, money, and even cutting down on heat, all by recycling the motion of the metro. So what do you think? Are the benefits of regenerative braking ironclad, or is it time to pull the emergency stop on this train of thought? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you didn't get your fill of the history of regenerative braking, I've got an extended version of this video over on Patreon. If you'd like to join, the link's in the description. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still Be Determined, will keep this conversation going. Keep your minds open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.